Hello, Verbal Shenanigans fans. We're excited to welcome a new sponsor to the show. So listen on up. We're embarking on a new year, and that means new sponsors. Since we know many of you are sports fans, you are going to love this. Our newest sponsor of the show is DynastySportsEmpire.com. Say it one more time, DynastySportsEmpire.com. Otherwise known as DSE, they are the world's largest dynasty and keeper fantasy league management company in the world. We're not talking about your cute little home league with Uncle Reno or Draft Queens or Fan Douche or one of those other companies. This is real fantasy general managing at its core. If you're tired of your mundane redraft league and have always wanted to retain your amazing team year in, year out, then DSE is where you want to be. They got fantasy hockey and hoops leagues now forming, so visit DynastySportsEmpire.com and see if you have what it takes to conquer their fantasy leagues today. That's DynastySportsEmpire.com. And again, we're very happy to welcome them to the Verbal Shenanigans family. We got a great episode for you today. Go check out DynastySportsEmpire.com.
This is Squire Fridell, and you've been listening, if you have listened, to me, burble on about the world of doing television commercials, Toyota, Ronald McDonald, that I was between 1984 and 1991. And you're listening to, and you heard me through Verbal Shenanigans. I hope you had a good time. I did.
But our shenanigans are cheeky and fun.
Yeah, I mean, his shenanigans are cruel and tragic.
Which makes them not shenanigans at all, really.
Evil shenanigans.
I swear to God, I'll pistol whip the next guy that says shenanigans.
Hello, everybody. Happy New Year. First episode out of the gate. Sorry we didn't give you one last week. It was just, the holidays. It was busy. You know, we just didn't feel like it.
Well, yeah. Scott, let me step in here for a sec. If people were on our social media, I mean, we always end the show talk about Facebook and Twitter and Instagram.
Yeah.
Everyone would have saw that we had the first ever Verbal Shenanigans event where we asked them just kind of a scavenger hunt, if you will.
Right.
We held it in D.C. We had a lot of people show up, and the big winner was the guy who was able to find that big podium and took it down for us.
That would be great sponsorship if we had a little sticker on that podium. You know.
Yeah. Wool Cap Willie, congratulations on that.
Would you allow the Buffalo head guy to be wearing Verbal Shenanigans pants? Would you sacrifice?
It's one of those odd balances. Like, in one way, you're like, oh, I don't want to be associated, but at the same time, you know, anybody like the second people saw them, they're like, what the hell? But then to add that visual and then pan down and see green Shamrock Verbal Shenanigans, yep, pants on him, yep, then they'll double down like, whoa, what the hell is this?
Yeah. Like, would you sacrifice like this? Probably like the second biggest douche in the country right now is that Buffalo head guy. Mm-hmm. But if your name was on or logo was on that, it probably is like the most shared image in the, maybe in the world at today, you know?
Or maybe I make them spread the word. So when that guy broke into Pelosi's office, instead of saying we will not stand down, it'd be like, hey, did you listen to the last episode with Soho Johnny?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we've been talking through this whole pandemic and time down, how, you know, we're going to keep going. We went to podcast, and this year was a wonderful year. It's very likely that this was the last year, because there might not be any more Earth soon. I really feel like it's coming. I really feel like someone's going to create their own nuke or piss off another country. And we're just going to be just Thanos right off of this planet. So every minute you talk, Mike, savor it, because this really could be the last episode of Verbal Shenanigans.
Well, I got nothing to say, so that pretty much sums up my life.
We'll never live to see Calorie Day come into full fruition.
You know how hard it was to find a dead giraffe to get it started? I mean, it's in my freezer right now. I had to buy a big one. Those ones that you got like lift up and it's like almost 3 feet high.
Yeah, yeah. But anyway, welcome to Verbal Shenanigans. First show out of the gate here this year. And this episode, we generally like to take a look back kind of at what happened last year. But on the podcast, that is. You guys all know what what happened in the United States over the last year. Whole lot of anything harmony. Important? Yeah, a whole lot of harmony, people getting along, helping.
Everybody going on vacation, having a blast.
Yeah, helping your fellow helping your fellow man out.
Tan lines on the face for whatever reason.
Civil discourse, you know, like just a lot of that going on. But so we're going to get into some of our favorite episodes of the year in just a little bit. But Mike, we got to talk.
What's up, buddy?
Now, I notice you have this Jack Skeleton hat on. Pretty cool little hat, you know.
Thank you.
The other day I see a picture of you in full headgear from, well, I guess it was a sweatshirt connected to the
It was a sweatshirt with a mesh that can zip up over your face, yeah.
Now, there's a picture of you walking your dog with the full thing zipped up, looking essentially, A, like maybe a terrorist, B, like it's Halloween, okay, mm-hmm. or C, just a man in his 40s dressing up as Jack Skeleton on the weekend. What's going on?
Well, that was a Christmas gift from the wife. In fact, where she got it was on the last Disney trip as we were going through the store. Like, as I was trying to find her, as she was seeing me walking, she's like, go back. I got something. Go back. All right. So that was like the big reveal surprise on there. I asked her, I needed some kind of like windbreaker or something. I got a Phillies one and I got a Jack Skellington one. Now I will say, I didn't know what it looked like with the Mets zipped up.
Right.
And I will say it kind of looked more like a Punisher skull than Jack Skellington, which kind of adds to the visual a little.
Had a bank robbery vibe to it. Kind of had like a, if you were driving down the street, you'd do like a double take if someone was walking their dog in these conditions. Now, I'm noticing you have transformed from a guy who didn't want to wear ears 3 years ago or maybe 4 years. I don't know. How long ago was your first Disney trip?
Oh, God. It's all blur right now. 3 or 4?
Okay.
I think we went before our wedding.
Let's call it 3.
If you can hear me, answer the question. What was our first Disney trip? I'll wait for the text.
Yeah, oh God, don't. She's gonna come swinging down with like a Disney like PowerPoint.
February 12th, 2017. I was informed.
So let's call it.
No reason.
Let's call that about 4 years.
Talk it to the public, honey. Go away. No. I'm a very important media person.
We shook Pandora's box there. We poked the bear.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the part of the horror movie where they're like, Are you sure you want to do that in this house?
Mm-hmm.
And then they're like, what could happen? And then like a horde of zombies and like a ghost shows up.
Yeah. So let's call it 4 years ago. You were a man who was dreading wearing the ears and reluctantly wore the ears. Now you're walking around as a skeleton man down the streets of Georgia.
Now, I will say I wore the sweatshirt, I didn't have it all zipped up the entire time.
Oh.
That was just like, put it up and let me take a picture moment. I didn't.
Now,
maybe I walked like that for maybe a few hundred feet, but nothing worse.
Until you got out of the bank.
As a side note, the picture in question was on the murder trail.
Oh, you revisited the murder trail.
We go there all the time.
Oh, I thought the murder trail was like a special one-time occasion. Now you're frequent to the murder trail in your skeleton sweatshirt.
Well, it's 15 minutes away from the house, and like it's pretty much a clear path, not really elevation. So it's
because everybody's been murdered. There's no traffic there.
No, there's only been one that's murdered there. And like I said, I think we upset her ghost as we were running in the pitch black that one night.
Now, I'm also noticing a picture with you with a Yoda strapped to your, or is that a sweatshirt with Yoda in a baby carrier?
The baby Yoda in it and think I'm going to walk around like that.
But you'll walk.
There are limits.
So, but the sweatshirt's okay, but not the actual Yoda carrier.
Not the actual carrier. If it's on the sweatshirt, it's like, oh, that's a cute little sweatshirt. You like the Mandalorian. That's right. Cool.
What was, so is this like a reverse? What was the movie with Tom? Was that Big? Where he's just going backward. Like soon you're going to be in full costume all the time.
Benjamin Button, you talking about?
No, I was talking about...
Benjamin Button is old to young. If you're talking about Big, it's young to old.
It's one of those. Big Button. Yeah. This is... So you're one step away from being like, you know, going to Comic Con, like full costume all the time. You're morphing, and I see it.
No, I don't think so.
You're... It's basically Halloween every day in the Burlew household, I think.
I mean, like right now, I'm wearing an Atlanta United shirt.
That's a nice shirt. But yeah. If we pan down, you're wearing nothing. Oh God!
Yep. My comfy sweatpants. You're welcome.
Maybe you could have wore those those shorts you were wearing. When you were doing that, was it leapfrogs or whatever?
Oh yeah, my boxer briefs when I was doing leapfrog exercises because my dog sat on me and got poop on me. So
yeah, like we're in like if this was a show, we're watching like season 5 of Michael Burlew, season 6, like where they're like really trying to spice up the character, and you're just kind of going off the deep end. This is what's happening.
Yeah. That's my life in a nutshell. Spent New Year's Day getting my huge finger pricked just to release some germs
for fun, people. For fun, he's just talking. That's what he does every New Year's. It's
yeah,
it's a weird tradition.
Yeah, I mean the doctor's like, I don't see anything wrong. I'm like, New Year, new scar. Put it in, baby.
Doc, you know it's January 1st. I like my finger pricked. It's Burlew family tradition.
I don't care about COVID. I'm willing to risk it.
Yeah, so last week you had a big blown up finger. What was the diagnosis of that?
Pretty much it was thinking just basically something from an ingrown nail or whatever. And yep. I went to like a minute clinic. Well, actually, I went to like the Walgreens, the ones that are in like the CVS's and all that.
The Walgreens in CVS's? George is weird. They're just combining.
I want to compare prices. Let me go further in the store. But no, the kind of like the practitioner nurse kind of deal. They call it Piedmont. I went to there. And I got one set of antibiotics, and then it basically did nothing for 2 days. So I got chewed out by the wife because she's like, I told you to go to Minute Clinic. And I'm like, I thought those like CVS things are what they call them, Minute Clinics. And I didn't know there was like a stage where it's like in between emergency room and...
Right,
and just like a regular doctor visit. I wasn't aware of that, so
I thought you were going to say she was mad that like your finger wouldn't fit in the Disney in like the Mickey hand, like it.
Seven. Go back on Shop Disney, order 2 new pairs. She's like, I got the extra large when your finger goes awry again, and the regular. But yeah, so then had to go to a Minute Clinic, and I lucked out. I was supposed to, they said 5-hour wait, but apparently, like, what I had could only be done in a specific room, which they don't really use. So I got in and out in, like, an hour. It's basically a room they had to keep sterile for whatever reason, for, like, tests. So since that's where I would have to go. They're just like, yeah, come on in. And then,
I was hoping it was like the employee bathroom. They're like, you know, we'll get you in and out of here. You know,
this is a dumpster. And you want to wait 5 hours? You want this done?
Prick away, sir. Prick away.
And it was just pretty much a doctor comes in, he goes, okay, he takes a razor out, gets a good nosh in there, a bunch of liquid comes out of it, and he's like, all right, here's some new antibiotics, get out of here.
So if let's say the wait was like 5 hours, 6 hours, and you knew that ahead of time, and the doctor sent you a video, this is all you got to do, just take a razor and do it, would you be able to do it on your own?
I'd be tempted. I'm a very impatient person. Like, even like when we were first checking for a local place, they're like, oh, 4 or 5 hours. And I was telling Izzy, I'm like, oh, I'll just like go home and go back in 3 hours and wait out the rest of the time. She said, no, you can't do that, blah, blah, blah. And it was like a back and forth on that. But yeah, I mean, I probably would have just sucked it up. I mean, maybe just go into the garage and I'll put some WD-40 on a razor blade, just hack at it.
Yeah, I mean, that's the natural way to do things.
Yeah.
Yeah, I could do, I think I could do like a pin. I've done a like a pin before when I've had like a blood blister or something like that. I don't know about a razor. That seems a little bit, that seems like the next step up from the pin.
Well, it's pretty much the equivalent to a pin, because all you're doing, it's not like you're, you know, cutting it in like a Thanksgiving turkey. You're just like, just taking the sharp side, go boom, and that's it. So,
all right, all right. Well, so on the show here, if you're just tuning in, we do like to talk about what's going on in life. We like to talk about the transformation of Mike Berlew, which is the last episode of the season. That's the title of it. But we definitely talk about life, but we also always bring on some amazing guests, generally amazing. I mean, I would say we're like 75% like amazing or interesting guests, I would say, more than that.
Yeah.
And we've had this, arguably, Mike, was, I mean, I think it has to be, as far as guests, the best year we've ever had. Because we were doing two a week in basically like April, May, June-ish, we were doing two a week, getting all sorts of names. So I would have to say this was probably the most interesting year for the podcast for guests. Would you agree?
Yeah, I would. I mean, just the range and the constant rotation and just everybody's availability. I would say, yeah, this is probably our best year for grabbing people and having some good interviews this year. Yeah.
So we always like to do a stupid bit, if you will. I don't know if you could call it a bit or a celebration of ourselves. That's how we always kind of start the year off. We have a couple weird traditions on the show, but usually our Christmas episode, our Halloween episode, our New Year's episode. And then we have a couple recurring bits and whatnot that
come next back. Week will be the most interesting recurring bit.
Yeah. We'll get into that next week, but that's going to be a tough one. So we like to break it down into categories, kind of talk about the year past, what we liked, what we didn't like, who surprised us. So we entitle them the Verbies. I know it's a very original name. It is the most honored award in podcasting. People are every year entering their nominations, who they think would be the best for it, how bad they want to get on the show for a chance to win it. So here we are, Mike, would you call these the 2020 Verbies or the 2021 Verbies?
I would say the 2020, because okay, that's the year it represents.
All right. So we break it down into a few categories, have some fun with it. So we'll do a few. We're going to get to a really cool guest in a few minutes. Let's recap, Mike. Let's be appreciative and look back at the year we've had. And
I will remember you.
And let's flush it out. Mike, I'm going to throw the ball to you as far as the first category on the show. We should read some of the names that we think fit into these categories. And then kind of talk about which was our favorite, what our picks were for the year.
All right. So I guess we'll start off with the sports, Scotty.
Sports! Speaking of sports, you should be maybe one of the biggest Eagle fans this year.
Yeah, I mean,
that was weird, wasn't it?
Hey, they want to give it up. They want to give it up. But thank you, Philadelphia, for benching your quarterback. So the Washington football team had a rather less stressful night that night.
Yeah, like I swear to God, I'm not bitter like that the Giants didn't get in, because they didn't deserve to be in. Honestly, the whole conference, if you will, division doesn't really deserve to be in, but it was a little non-sanctimonious ending to the season. Like after we got the win over Dallas, and it's like, oh, the Eagles are right in this. This is a good game, and it's like, what the hell is going? Oh no!
Who was that?
So it was a bit of a letdown. I mean, I'm okay with the direction the Giants are going. I'm very okay with the direction the Mets are going, baby. Welcome Lindor, baby. So it was a little bit of a weird ending to the season, which I have always said, and everybody always tells me the Cowboys, but I have always at least for the last 10, 15 years, I've hated the Eagles more than the Cowboys.
I can see that. Like, I mean, growing up being a Washington fan, like my biggest hate was the Giants because I lived in Jersey.
Yeah.
And then there was like a 4-year stretch where they beat us every time. And it wasn't even like you guys were great and we sucked or vice versa. It was like we were both equal and you guys always had our number for some reason. So it's always like
that's how I felt about the Eagles in the last like decade. They always upset the Giants. They're always like winning or getting that win or big comebacks. They drive me nuts.
I would probably say I lean towards Philly and hatred more recently myself, and all because I mean they got a little cocky with that Super Bowl, and then they were talking dynasty, and that
they're terrible.
Then they're that weird team where it's like even when they suck, they kind of show up, and you're like, get out of here.
But, yeah. All right, Mike. So you're gonna we're gonna go with sports out of the bat. So Mike, why don't you give us a little bit of a rundown of just some of the sports guests we've had on the show this year. You don't have to do them all, but name some of the highlights here.
We had Dan Severn, former UFC and WWE wrestler. We had Aaron Fitzgerald, who was a helicopter pilot, X Games. We had Michael Bent, former heavyweight champion of the world. We had Kirby Chambliss, one of our favorite recurring guests here from Red Bull Air Races, Rugby Atlanta, Lee Allen, Amon Matthews. We had the San Diego Chicken, Ted Giannalis. I think I said it right.
I'm just enjoying you pronounce Amon Matthews and Ted Giannalis.
Yeah, I actually got that right. If you listen to the interview, never got his name right once. But this time, I came prepared.
Yeah, from Rugby Atlanta. That was cool.
Yep. Yeah. Kyle Croxall. What was that? Red Bull Crushed Ice.
Crushed Ice.
Coach Jim Johnson. Jack O'Halloran, former boxer. Butterbean, Eric Esch. Luke Aitken, extreme sports guy. Jumped out of an airplane without a parachute, landed into a net. Former NASCAR driver, Bill Lester. Mm-hmm. Former Chiefs wide receiver J.J. Burden and Joe Daddy Stevenson,
former UFC,
on Kingdom.
Yes. You could put I'm not going to count them right now, but I don't know, 12, 15 guests, sports related. This was a tough one. I guess I'll go first.
Okay.
Now, last year, right around this time of year, so pumped to get Dan Severn on the show. Loved the interview. It was a little hard to hear because he was in the airport. But just being able to talk to Dan Severn was amazing. I loved Aaron Fitzgerald and Luke Aikens. I kind of felt like him, Kirby, and
kind of like a trilogy of Red Bull athletes.
Exactly. And they do all these videos together. and they kind of recommend each other. So those guys have a close place in my heart, and I would have any one of them on again. And, you know, Kirby is my favorite
recurring guest.
Kirby and Tom Verney, the two of them, complete opposites. Mm. But Kirby Chambliss, Red Bull Air Race pilot, we've had him on 3 times, I think. And I love having him on. Loved having Joe Daddy on, another one that was a little hard to hear, but it was a really cool interview. He was driving at the time. But Bill Lester was a fascinating interview. But this year, I went with former heavyweight champion Michael Bent.
That's a good choice.
Yeah. So I had gotten the idea to interview him from a documentary on Netflix called Losers, I believe. Or was it Losers? Mm-hmm. Well, I can't remember.
Yeah, it was Losers, I believe.
Loser. And it was Michael Bent. It wasn't really about as much of him being an amazing boxer. It was about like this mental hurdle he had to get over. He had a dad that was very abusive and things like that. And he turned into like a director or like a consultant on movies where he's done some acting, but he's also like instructing guys on how to box. And I just thought he was like a super appreciative, down to earth guy. And I felt like he really enjoyed the interview back and forth. So my pick for the sports interview of the year was Mr. Michael Bent.
That was a good pick. And add to it, he still has love for boxing, even with all the abuse you talk about and basically getting like legitimate lights out, knocked out, where there was a question if he was going to live after that. So
yeah, yeah. And he was just like, he's a guy I would bring on again. And maybe like, he's a guy I don't think I even have to talk about boxing with. You know what I mean? Like the next interview could be like just talking about life and things like that. And it was really cool to hear his transformation into acting and whatnot. So my pick is Michael Bent.
Okay. One name I forgot to of the list, Phil Pritchard, the keeper of the cup.
Yep.
Stanley Cup was also on our list. As I go through my list, I mean, you brought up some Bill Lester, fascinating interview. Dan Severn, just getting him, even with all the hearing all of the flights boarding behind him, was really cool to deal with. I was torn between two. For a while, I was thinking I was going to go with Ted Ginales, the San Diego Chicken.
Yep.
But I think on coolness and the conversation, I'm going to go with Luke Akins. With just like, it wasn't even like talking about just the stunt itself. It was a really laid back talk where I kind of would think like Michael Bent, where it's like, if he comes back on, we could just talk like guy stuff or whatever. And not blink an eye, him like chatting about how they'll just be like drinking a beer and literally somebody will spitball something and then they'll start figuring out that it can be done or whatever.
Yep.
And even the emotional part where we talked about like the day before, he's like, where are the kids coming? And the wife's like, I don't want the kids there just in case. And all the like weird conflicting stuff when you're doing something that literally, like, the second somebody sees it, they're like, oh, it's so awesome. But getting all the innards of it emotionally and all the testing and so forth. So I'm going to go with Luke Akins.
I can't argue that one. Luke Akins was up there. Like I said, that trio of guys kind of, like, almost felt like a group in a way. I love them all. I was also thinking the San Diego Chicken, and my second place was actually going to be Phil Pritchard. Just because I think Phil Pritchard was, he's in charge of the Stanley Cup and around. I just think he was one of the most unique, like, to get that guy on the podcast was a long process, and I wasn't sure it was going to happen. And I just, like, think his job is so interesting that, like, he was a great guest to talk to. So
totally agree.
All right. Mike, your category, your choice. It's my choice, right? Yep.
Yep, I did the one.
All right. I'm going to go with I'm going to go with the category of what we are calling I guess you can call it art.
Okay.
Now, we have a list of people that you can mention that are artists and whatnot, but you can kind of interpret this any way you want. A music artist, an actor could be an artist, but we were thinking more kind of like art, visually,
correct.
Things like that. So some of the people we interviewed were Heather Berman, a former Rockette. I think she was right at the tail end of the year, that gray area, you know. Sarah Kaufman, the cheese lady. John Bramblett, who was a blind artist, an amazing guy to talk to, which I still remember. I got to order his piece that I was supposed to order. Howard Berger, the special effects for K&B, Walking Dead stuff, among the many other things. Russ McCamey, controversial guest that we had on the show this year that runs the McCamey Manor, which is like the scariest haunted house, if you will, and I don't even know what it is anymore. Our friend Natty Bumper Car, who did the children's book, Douglas. Joe Carney, Kevin Eastman, creator of the Ninja Turtles. There's a lot that you can kind of interpret as art. So I'm curious, Mike, where you went with this.
I think I looked over the scenarios. I thought about our buddies, Joe and Natty, on that, because I'm happy for them. And again, Douglas, the Christmas tree, go out and buy the book. Beautiful story. Have it ready for next Christmas. But I went with John Bramblett. I thought, you know, as much as we like talked about the blind artist, I can legitimately say, like, looking at his site, it should be just artists. Just amazing paintings, an incredible story of what he told us, where he wasn't really in this before he lost his sight, but incredibly happy and incredibly laid-back guy. Had a lot of great conversation with him, and overall it was just it was a real good feeling after talking to him, you know? So yep. That's why I kind of lean towards John Bramblett.
No argument here. Love this interview. One of my favorites of the year by far. And his work is actually pretty cool. It's like really, I don't know. It's cool, like wall artwork. I went with who was a guy who was in the running for interview of the year for me. I was so excited for this interview, because this was an email I had sent out. I have no idea how long before. It seemed like a year. I don't know. And then randomly an email came back. Kevin is doing interviews this Saturday or whatever. Saturday morning. It was a morning. And you you have a 15-minute time slot or whatnot. You get to talk to him, ask him anything you want. And now, this was such a connection for me, because, like, Ninja Turtles when I was a kid was absolutely, like, it was everything. Like, if there was a wheelhouse for Scott's, like, main, like, playing with toys and movies and a cartoon that came out, that was mine. It was the Ninja Turtles. Ghostbusters, Ninja Turtles. And to be able to talk to Kevin Eastman was like a real honor. I was really pumped about it. We had planned our interview, which was like something we don't normally do. You know, no, we plan like what we're going to ask sometimes, but we really like planned it down to a T, and it was kind of like an accomplishment. He even gave us like an extra like 5 minutes or so. And one of my favorite interviews to date on this podcast was the creator, co-creator of the Ninja Turtles, Kevin Eastman.
Yeah, I got to be honest, though, Scott. I've been looking at Rowan, and I don't see us in there. I mean, we specifically ended the interview with, you're making the story anyway. You can just put us in the background somewhere. I don't want to be, like, the main character. I'll eventually become the main character. But,
well, yeah, you'll be in, like, a sweatshirt and your...
Skullhead!
But yeah, one of my absolute favorite interviews that we've ever done, Kevin Eastman.
All right,
Mike, balls in your court.
I think we're going to do science and supernatural, Scott.
The science and supernatural. All right.
Do you miss people screaming that when you do trivia?
Science? No, not at all.
You think somebody who went there for like the first time is like, dude, I got an original idea. Watch this. Science!
All right. We had a couple on this one.
Yeah, we had quite a few and a decent amount. We had Dennis Kowalski, who was a part of the Cryonics Institute. We got to talk about freezing dead bodies to see if they come back. One of our
How's that going for you, by the way? Did
I mean, with the draft meet, I got a couple people in the freezer. Still haven't come back yet. You know, I check in every once in a while.
Right.
I'll keep you posted. Do I have to keep it plugged in all the time?
I don't know, man. I know it's high on the electric bill, so I don't know.
Yeah, that's my concern. So, Zoltan Istvan, who is a transhumanist and actually attempted to run as a Republican candidate for presidency, came a tad short to President Trump, soon to be.
I'm going to go out on a limb here and say that he might have been a better choice.
Might have worked. He got my vote in 2016. As much as I joke around, he did get my vote in 2016.
All right.
Cliff Berrickman from the Finding Bigfoot series, and he has the Bigfoot Institute over in Oregon. Toby Brousseau, he did the Rocket Man Mad Mike documentary. That Mad Mike was the gentleman who built a rocket to prove that the world was flat and shoot himself into the sky. And sadly, later in 2020, his attempt failed and he passed away. Mike Reynolds, the garbage warrior and creator of Earthships. Artie Hoffman, our radio psychic. Jean-Pierre Giannoli, who was a part of the Southern California Paranormal Detectives. And Justin O. Schmidt, Nobel Prize winner for creating the Sting Pain Index. Basically, every possible insect that could bite or sting, he made an entire index on the levels of pain and actually wrote a book on all the feelings of getting stung by all of them.
All right. I guess the ball is in my court on this one.
Yep.
Now, I liked a lot of these interviews. We started with Dennis Kowalski. He was very informative. That was early on in the year. I remember being kind of excited about that. It was different. Really loved Cliff Berrickman, the Finding Bigfoot guy. I know you're a controversial figure in the Bigfoot world, Mike. but he turned out to be great. Artie Hoffman, okay, he was a nice guy. Did anything he tell you come true? Because he told me that I was going to have a 70s Volkswagen bus appear somewhere, and it's going to mean a lot to me. No bus yet, Mike.
No bus? I mean, is there an expiration on that? Do you have to go back to the dealer for a warranty check or something like that?
Well, my car is finally getting repaired after getting hit by a dump truck. So maybe he was a little cloudy that day. Maybe he was.
Oh, okay.
I saw a documentary on, I think it was Amazon Prime or something like that, about these things called Earthships, which was like sustainable living and building things out of bottles and tires and things like that. And I wasn't even sure if Mike Reynolds was still like alive, because I know he had gotten sick and whatnot. Mike was a little rough around the edges, but I thought his information and I thought just getting him on the show was really cool. And there's like a whole following of Mike. There's a lot of people friended the show or followed the show on Instagram and whatnot. So I went with Mike Reynolds, the Garbage Warrior.
Solid pick right there. That was very enjoyable. For me, I mean, as I go down the list, like you said, Dennis was really interesting, just like talking about the whole process and everything they go through to make sure everything stays open and why people go into cryonics. Toby Brousseau, had a lot of fun chatting with him. I know we had a huge laugh talking about the scene where they had to actually like get dolls out and explain what they're going to do when he gets into space. It was very, very fun, unique kind of, documentary. Oddly enough, we had to reschedule because literally, Mad Mike died like 2 days before we were scheduled to talk to him. So that was a little insane.
Mm-hmm.
Always enjoy getting Zoltan in there, but I think I'm going to go with Justin O. Schmidt. I think he was a fun guy, laid back guy. Just kind of interesting to hear some of the stories about you know, why he went through it, and even like working with his other scientists where he'll just be like, no, just pick them up, and then just hearing like guys screaming in the back as you're doing their work, and just the fact that somebody came on the show and told us that somebody wanted to get a bullet wasp and sting their testicles with. I mean, I know he's a Nobel Prize winner, but I think the testicle thing put him over in my head.
Yeah, he was great. He was really like interesting and you know, you could tell he's been through like a million different things, and like he's just kind of like, I don't need to be doing these interviews with these idiots, but you could tell he's definitely a really interesting guy that you could probably talk to for hours and get like crazier stories out of. So I completely agree with that pick. He was up there for me. So we're going to continue this after our guest here. We're going to go to a guest and shift gears here, because that's kind of what the show is. It's as Mike says, it's a potpourri of entertainment, if you will. So we're looking forward to this year. We got a lot of really cool guests lined up, some big ones we're still fishing on. But today, we are joined by a former actor, author, and now winemaker. You might know him, you might know his face from like Toyota commercials, but you might know his face in makeup, if you will, in a red wig, if you will. He was known as one of the official Ronald McDonalds. He owns a very successful winery right now. He's been in, I forget what the number commercials he said. It was some
3,600, I believe.
Yes, some astronomical number. But we're going to get Squire Fridell on the show. So here's our interview with Squire.
I guess right off the bat, usually we start off these interviews by asking, like, how's everybody been doing through the pandemic? I'm kind of curious. I know your daughter, Lexi, does acting off of Broadway. I'm kind of curious of how she's going along with everything and how things have been out there.
Well, a couple of things. Broadway is, as you know, shut down, and we've been doing whatever we can to help our Broadway friends. We've done kind of a group podcast thing with them, a subscription deal where we did a wine tasting and they sang and danced. And it was just wonderful. But, you know, the whole industry is in, as many industries are throughout the world, is in deep, dire straits. So that's where that is. Our daughter had a baby who's 13 months old. And so that kind of put everything on hold. And she and her husband and the baby have decided, after all of this, and I'm sure the pandemic had something to do with it, to eventually take over the winery and the operation here. So it's really worked out quite well. It's what I've always fervently wished for, but never been able to vocalize. So it was the COVID and plus the fires of 2017 and 2020 kind of clinched that decision for them, which is just wonderful.
Now, Squire, you've been in, it seems like, endless amounts of commercials and acting projects. Were you a like classically trained actor? Were you always trying to be an actor from a young kid, or was it something that you kind of got into later on?
Kind of backed into it. You know, everybody who ends up to be my age and you ask them what they did and how they got there, it seems to be a whole series of connect the dots to get them where they are today. I have a master's in theater, and I taught 9 years in high school and about 4 years in colleges. And during that time, because it was in Southern California, I began to audition for acting jobs. My first jobs weren't commercials. They were regular episodic television stuff. And I did that for a while and then ended up getting a commercial agent. And I guess because I have a 30-second attention span, that's where I ended up gravitating to. And then in 1980, I had a wonderful fellow who was my commercial agent, who's passed away now, but a wonderful man. And we started talking about it, and he said, you know, there's no book on how to do television commercials. And he said, you know, you're pretty literate, and you ought to think about writing one. So I did, and it came out in 1980. And at that time, I think I'd done about, oh, golly, I don't know, 500 television commercials, certainly more than most.
Right.
And so I published it and through Random House, and it came out, and it is still available, if you can believe it or not. It's the fourth edition of it, but many, many printings, and it's been out now for 40 years on the shelves, and you can get it, still get it through Amazon Prime. It's pretty
That's
amazing.
Awesome.
So it was the
Absolutely.
First book. And in fact, I'm standing here in our entryway and I'm looking at, we've got one that's framed, that's the first edition, and then the new one, which is looks a little bit different, but I had to redo it and all of that. So it's kind of cool. So that's when I read the book. And then, strangely enough, as I started to learn more about why certain people worked in the industry and why they didn't, and it's the art of the audition, obviously, I started to identify those things that people did, including me and including other actors, that got them a callback and got them a job. And I had a couple of friends that were in the business in casting, and they allowed me to sit down and watch the videotapes of auditions. And literally, I took all of that stuff that my friends were doing in the audition, and I put it in black and white, and was able to really identify why certain people ended up getting a job and certain people, and the majority of people, did not. And it really helped me in auditioning. So I went from about 500 commercials to, before I quit, was 3,400 commercials.
Wow.
That's it?
Yeah, and it really is quite objective when you think about it.
Hmm. Out of curiosity, when you're doing these, you're going in for these commercials, is it more acting or is it more energy going into it? Because it, like, just even like randomly looking up a couple of your commercials, like I came across one for Twix where you had to play like a defendant for the candy bar to prove that it was chocolate and caramel, but still crispy. So I'm not sure how much is classic acting versus just going out there and having fun with it.
Well, you know, you said a couple of key things in there. I don't know how many times I've heard a director say to actors, just have fun with it. That's number one. When I asked my agent, his name was Penn Dennis, and when I asked him why he thought I worked more than most people, and I thought perhaps he would say, well, it's because you have a master's in theater with an emphasis on George Bernard Shaw and Gilbert and Sullivan for musicals, but he didn't at all. He just thought for a moment. He said, well, you have more energy than most, and I thought that was a good thing. So I always kept that first and foremost. If you're energetic about something, it means you're kind of passionate about it, and it doesn't really make any difference what you do in life as a career, either vocation or avocation, but having energy and passion about it really pays off. And it's paid off in the same way, because we took that same skill set, quite frankly, and when we started making wine and growing grapes 35 years ago.
So,
and as a result, we've been very successful at that.
So how did you end up entering the Ronald McDonald world and the McDonald's advertising? Were you the first choice? Was this something that you knew what you were getting into? Because it's kind of a, you know, it's something that's lasted close to, I don't know, 40 years, something like that.
7 years, yeah.
Yeah. So how did you get into that?
It's interesting. We lived in Southern California, and my agent, Penn, called and he said, you have an audition today. And I said, great. And so I wrote down all the information, where it was, what it was for. He said, I don't know what the product is, but it's kind of secretive, but it's a clown-like character. And so I thought, well, that's interesting. So I stopped off on my way to the audition at Hollywood Magic, and I bought some juggling balls because I can juggle. And I bought a couple of little magic tricks, you know, where things appear out of the air and, you know, a little, because I thought, well, this might help me in the audition. It's one of my tips that I found another actor doing, and I literally stole it and put it in my book. And so I went in the audition, and they didn't say what the product was. It was more of a of an improv situation. And I did the audition while I was juggling. And it was just a solo thing. There were no partners. And they had a little monologue that, that you did. And so I read the words off the cue sheet, and I juggled and whatever, and I forgot about it. And then about 3 months later, I got a call from my agent again, who said, you have a callback. And I said, oh, that's good. For what? And he said, it was that one that you did with a clown-like character. I don't know what the product is, but do you remember that? And I look back in my notes, because I keep accurate notes, and I said, oh, yeah, that was the one where I took them juggling balls. And so on my way up, I stopped off, and I picked up my juggling balls and the other magic things that I had. And I opened the door and walked inside, and there were six or seven guys dressed up like Ronald McDonald. They were other actors that were also auditioning. So I thought, oh, I get it. Clown-like character and a little slow. And so I got in makeup and the costume just like the other actors, and I knew most of them, because it was a very small fraternity of guys that were sort of Procter & Gamble white bread guys. And so I got dressed up and I went inside and I did the same thing I did in the audition before, in the original call. And I juggled and did a thing and, you know, sang a song or do what I read. And then I left and I forgot about it. And then about 2 months later, they called and said, would you like to do the backup for Ronald McDonald? And I said, well, I don't know what that is. What's a backup? And they said, well, there's an actor that's already Ronald, you probably know. And I said, no, I didn't, but yeah, sure. And his name was King Moody. He was the first Ronald of the ones that you would recognize. People always think that Willard Scott was the first Ronald McDonald. And he was a Ronald, but he was kind of a prototype. And he, you wouldn't really recognize him as Ronald. He had a box of food in his head and a Dixie cup for a nose. But, you know, I have a video of these things. And so I went in and I met King, and we had known each other from auditioning on other things. And I became his backup. And that lasted for about 2 months. And then they said, well, we're going to replace King, who was getting a bit older, and you're going to be Ronald. And I said, well, that's good. And so then that started the Ronald McDonald thing, which went on for about 7 years. So lucky, right place, right time.
Right.
Yeah. And so, I mean, you had some key roles. You were the Toyota man. Now you're Ronald McDonald. Now, when you get into these deals, out of curiosity, does it set you up for more stuff, or does companies like Toyota and McDonald's kind of lock you down where you're like, you're our guy, you can only do like our stuff for commercials?
Well, it all depends how you negotiate things. The character or the actor who plays Ronald McDonald really isn't easily identified. And so there's not really a problem with having a conflict. When I got the McDonald's gig, I was already doing Toyota. That lasted for 29 years,
jeez,
if you can believe that.
Wow.
So I was their spokesman, and I didn't even ask them because there was no conflict. The only thing I really couldn't do was another car. And so I became Ronald while I was doing the Toyota stuff. The problem was that when I was early on in the days, before I was even doing many television commercials, and just before I wrote my book, I was under contract to Universal Studios, one of the last of the contract players, where they would loan you out every week and do a different show. It was a fun program, and I got to do a whole bunch of television stuff. And then, but I was doing a lot of commercials on the side. And when Universal came along and said, we want to put you under contract, and I said, oh, that's good. Gee. That's nice. And they said, but you can't do anything else. You can't do any commercials or whatever. And I looked at them and I said, do you have any idea how much money you can make doing television commercials? And it was before Johnny Paycheck's song Take This Job and Shove It came along. But that's probably what I would have said. I said, this is being ridiculous. And they said, well, okay, we'll have to get back to you. And then Universal came back and they said, okay, well, you can do a you can do commercials. And so, because I would have had to give up Toyota at that point. So it really worked out quite well. I didn't even ask McDonald's if I could continue to do Toyota because they didn't see that there was a conflict. Nobody would recognize it was the same guy.
Right. Mm. Now tell us about.
It really was the mainstay. It was the one that was the longest commercial gig by far. But the McDonald's one, the reason I cherish that so much is that the day I signed the contract is the day we put our house on the market on the beach in Southern California and began to move up to the wine country. And that changed our lives.
Yeah, that was going to be my next question. How did you guys enter the wine world?
I'm sorry. You got real low then.
Yeah, no problem. That was my next... Something's going on with my tech side. But that was my next question for you. How did you guys actually enter the wine world? And when did that actually become, an option for a lifestyle and a business?
Well, it was certainly, as we look back on it now, my wife and I talk about it often. It really seemed like kind of a foolhardy thing to do. Life was going quite well. I was sort of top of the world in number of commercials and be as busy as I could possibly be. But I got overdoing a job one day, and my wife and I were looking down on the beach because we had a beach house. And there were a bunch of 14-year-old kids having a good time on the beach, but they were smoking dope, drinking beer, and being rowdy. I looked at my wife, and we looked at our little brand-new baby crawling around the carpet, little girl, and thought, gee, maybe this isn't a perfect place to raise a family on the beach in Southern California. And I thought, gee, what can I possibly do? I can't really move because I got to be where the action is. I got to be able to audition. And I thought, if I can get one more commercial contract other than Toyota, which I already had, maybe we can make this thing fly. So I auditioned for everything. I became Carl, the Good Seasons vegetable guy. I was the Spirit of Dawn, where I would magically appear in ladies' kitchens, telling her if they use Dawn dishwashing detergent, their marriages would be more fulfilling. I was Mr. Whipple's nephew, Orville Redenbacher's nephew. I squeezed the Charmin. I sat with Mrs. Olson many a morning and drank Folger's coffee, but it didn't seem like any of those would be the one. And then, as fortune would have it, the guy who was the original Ronald McDonald was getting a little bit older, and they would put out a call for an audition, and I, along with 4,000 other guys in New York, Chicago, and L.A. auditioned. I got the job. So the day I signed the contract is the day we put our house on the market and physically began to move up here. All of my actor friends said, what the hell are you doing? What are you doing? And it seemed kind of absurd at the time. And I thought, I think this is the right thing to do. I really do. It was for our little girl. And as a result, we moved up here, and she was raised up here. We live on 20-some acres, and we built a home, planted a couple of vineyards, and started to make wine and got quite good at it.
What's harder, breaking into the acting business or breaking into the wine business?
Oh, I don't know. I think no matter – if you think about it as breaking into something – I don't think you're probably going to do too well. I think if you would just approach it with enthusiasm and a sort of a eyes wide open wonder and work real hard at it, it's going to happen. Just like remember the Gene Wilder Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, one of my favorite movies. Mm-hmm. And he has a line at the very end when he's in the airplane flying with a little boy. And he turns to the little boy and he says, don't ever forget what happened to the man who suddenly got everything he always wanted. He lived happily ever after. And I've always thought that was kind of cool. So I don't think it really makes much difference what you decide to do. It's how you do whatever you're going to do.
Hmm. It seems like from like looking at IMDb, haven't done much acting since 96, at least in like TV and video games and stuff like that. Did you just make a conscious decision to dedicate more to the wine side of the business, or were you just having enough doing the travel and doing the other stuff?
Well, traveling got to be, after we moved here up in Sonoma Valley, traveling got to be a bit of an issue. The first 3 years that we lived here, I think I averaged 55 plane trips a year.
Jeez.
So it was difficult. But I knew there was an end to it, and I knew that if we applied ourselves and were diligent with our money, that life would eventually pay off pretty well. So, and it has. So I don't know. I don't think you really plan much of that stuff. I think if you're a good person and you do good philanthropic things and you don't hurt people,
yeah,
that Mother Nature's going to kind of take care of you. I think so.
Yeah. Yeah. So let me ask you, do you still have any temptation to act or get back into commercials, or is it kind of all wine and that kind of side of your life now?
You know, even if you are a successful actor, you still have to do what everybody says.
Right.
You have a director, you have producers, you have clients, you have the ad agency, you have Universal Studios, you have whoever, director, whoever it is, but they tell you what to do, where to go, where to stand, when to say your words, et cetera, when to be wherever you have to be in the morning. And what I do now is I tell myself what to do.
That's great.
So we have wine that is going to be bottled in March because I set the date. I hired the truck. I made the wine. We grew the grapes. And everything is dictated by what my choices are. And I like this a lot. I've never found anything that is more gratifying and more rewarding than doing what I do now.
It's great.
You know, there's no greater pleasure in life I've ever had than somebody opens a bottle of wine that you made and said, you know, this stuff's pretty good. That makes me smile a lot.
That's awesome.
Ah, and you're pretty successful. You're coming, what's that, 34 years now?
Yeah, we're having a 35th harvest this year. And we're just about to start pruning, which will happen at the end of February, the vineyards here. And then we just make decisions. You know, you bump into a vineyard, and you have a conversation with somebody. I was president here at Sonoma Valley Vineyards and Growers. And you bump into somebody, and he says, yeah, you know, I've got some Cabernet Sauvignon up in Moon Mountain. You might be interested in picking up a ton or two. And you do, and you end up making a wine out of it, and it's you're making something from whole cloth.
Right.
There's something enormously rewarding about all of that. I like it a lot.
So tell us a little bit about it's GlenLyon Winery. Do you do tours? How do people go about obtaining your wines?
Well, you can go to the website and just take a look. We have the good fortune, since we've been doing it so long now, I can only make a couple of thousand cases of wine. That's my permit. And we are sold out. When I make the wine, it's gone.
It's a good problem.
We have over 1,000 wine club members. The reason it's called GlenLyon is my wife is a Scot. And there is a real place in Scotland called GlenLyon, where her family was from. And when we got married in 1977, her parents bought me my kilt, which I still wear for most special occasions. And when we were going to name the place up here, because you got to name everything, the Squire Fridell Winery just run trippingly over the tongue.
So nice.
We took a look at Susie's side of the family, and her clan crest, because if you're a Scot, you have a tartan and you wear a kilt, and they all have clan crests. In the middle of her clan crest was a wild boar. And when we bought this property, there were wild boar rooting everywhere here because there was nothing here. It's just trees and hills. And so that seemed to fit. And then we discovered her family was from the GlenLyon region in the Highlands in Scotland, and we live in GlenLyon. So we thought we'd call it GlenLyon, and we did. And it's worked out pretty well.
That's awesome.
So you're saying people weren't screaming to have a nice 94 Chateau de Squire is what you're trying to tell
no,
us.
No, no. yeah. So if somebody gets our wine and they enjoy it, I always send it back a little note and I said, just if anybody asks you where you got the wine, I said, ah, oh, some clown made it.
Well, Scott's having a little bit of an issue on his end, so I'm going to kind of finish this off. I want to thank you, Squire, for joining us today. If people want to, try out some of your wine and find out about the different types that you have, where can they go for this information?
Well, I make a total of 11 different wines, believe it or not, and we're very, very small. But, we have a small wait list to get into our wine club, our clan. And it's pretty neat. We've had people come out here, and if they do get in the area, they might give a shout and just mention your name and say, gee, I heard you on the little podcast thing, and I'd love to see your place. And I say, sure, well, if I got time, let's set up a day and a time, and I'll give you directions.
Awesome.
So that's kind of how it works. And, when we first started this years and years ago, it occurred to me, how in God's name are you going to sell your wine? It's easy to make wine. It's hard to sell wine because there's a lot of competition out there. Go to supermarket and look. Go to Costco. There's a lot of wine out there. But I was always a pretty good businessman. It's called show business. And very often we emphasize the first part and not the latter. And I always, particularly when I wrote my book, I had a long Christmas card list. All the dealers, the Toyota dealers, you can imagine after 29 years of doing Toyota commercials, how many dealers that you've met at conventions and things like that. And I always picked up a card from everybody, and I mail them a copy of my book. They say, gee, it was really nice seeing you in Las Vegas and Birmingham and Nashville and New York, whatever it happened to be. And and I just mail them a copy of my book, and they'd put it on the table and go, oh, gee. And then they were thinking about doing commercials, and then they'd say, remember that kid, and here's his book, and gee, why don't we call him up and have him audition? So that's how it all seemed to work. So when we first started the winery, that was our initial mailing list and said, we decided we'd move to the wine country and start to make wine. And if you'd like to try a bottle of it, give me a shout. And we would, and I would send him a bottle of wine or whatever. And still many of those people, believe it or not, are in our wine club.
Nice.
And that's the only way you can get our wine is by belonging to the wine club. And a bunch of them, the people that I used to work with 30 years ago, 40 years ago, are still in the wine club. So that makes me smile a lot. And then when they get an opportunity to come out here, we have a really remarkable place out here that we created, that we built. You can see pictures of it on the site. It's just gorgeous. It's GlenLyonVineyards.com. Anyway, that's kind of how all that worked.
It's awesome.
That's the way life goes. It's beautiful. Final question for you. Were you able to keep the Ronald McDonald costume, and do you ever put it on?
No, I don't have the costume, but I did steal a pair of shoes. don't tell the McDonald's Corporation that I stole a pair of their shoes, but I've got them, and they're out here. I have a when our daughter now is, a mom herself, but some years back, she gave me a sign for Christmas, and it was one of those funny signs, like clowns exit through the back door. It was kind of cute, and I had nowhere to put it, and we had a bathroom downstairs, because we kind of decorate a lot of things. We had a bathroom downstairs, and I thought, I've got a bunch of old Ronald McDonald stuff in the barn. And I wonder if I can find those boxes. So I went down and I had about three boxes, giant boxes, of all this Ronald McDonald paraphernalia that people had given me and I collected over the years, from, watches and clocks and telephones and all kinds of stuff. And so we devoted this bathroom to the Ronald McDonald bathroom, and I have the shoes up on the wall. It's kind of cute. Anyway, you'd have to see it. So next time you get out to the West Coast, post-COVID, give a shout, and we'll taste wine up in our overlook.
Sounds great.
I'll definitely take you up on that offer. Squire, Thank you so much for your time. Stay safe out there, and we appreciate you coming on our show.
You bet. Thanks, nice talking to you guys.
All right, Mike, we had Tony the Tiger. We had the Kool-Aid Man. We had, I guess the San Diego Chicken could fit fit somewhere in there. We're knocking out the mask. Oh, who else do we have?
We had the Sprint Turn.
Oh yeah, yeah. We're taking down corporate America's symbols and getting them on
the
show.
The office linebacker.
Oh, Terry Tate. I love you, Terry. Terry, if you made a tournament of favorite guests ever, Terry would probably get into the at least the Elite Eight. He was so good. Squire Fridell, everybody. All right, Mike, we got a couple more categories to go before we kind of – this is always like our catapult into the year, so – and we don't do this. We kind of do this also if you're listening for the first time. Like, there's a lot of episodes to go back and check out. So here we go. Mike, I believe the ball is in your court. And if it's not, it's
not
in your court.
The last one.
Oh.
I did the, Science and Supernatural, so it's your check.
Oh, way to be so factual. God damn it. All right. I am – all right. I'll knock one of our biggest categories out of the park here. We're going to go with acting, production, TV, movie. So basically film, I guess you can call that. That's actually, funny that it's funny that we've never had a word for it, but I really think film might kind of sum up, all these people.
I guess, but I mean, you could technically say production because I mean, some kind of like our, makeup artists and stuff like that, but.
All right. So on the list we have Michael Bent, who we mentioned. Mike, the coming together of my gift to you, my ultimate gift to you, Tom Wopat. You have had both Dukes of Hazzard on the show, which was like, you don't understand the excitement I had knowing we're interviewing Tom Wopat. And then we had John Schneider on the first. John Schneider was the ultimate because it was right in time when you were leaving. And we were kind of like, oh, we'll keep the show going. But we weren't sure exactly, I guess, technology-wise, how we'd do it. And if it would be the same. Arguably, it's been way better. So you've had both Dukes of Hazzard on the show, which is when we're old and we can tell our kids, I had both Dukes of Hazzard, and they're like, what, that old racist show from the 70s?
I wasn't racist back then. You don't understand.
You don't get it.
And what was the name of your football team again? We don't talk about that.
Howard Berger, who we mentioned before, K&B effects artist. Toby Philpott, the puppeteer for Jabba the Hutt. Jamie Lynn Watson, the Sprint Girl. Jack O'Halloran, who we mentioned before, he was in Superman. Larry Hankin, who has been in a bazillion things you've seen. Escape from Alcatraz, Happy Gilmore, Breaking Bad. Cliff Barrickman from Finding Bigfoot. Kevin Eastman in Ninja Turtles. David Howard Thornton from the Terrifier movies. Toby Brasseau, Mike Reynolds, who we just mentioned before. Bruce Valanche, Hollywood Squares, iconic figure. Sean Cannon from The Karate Kid and General Hospital.
General Hospital.
Charles Baker from Breaking Bad, a.k.a. Skinny Pete. William Hung, She Bangs, She Bangs from American Idol. American Frank Art. Sims, the Kool-Aid Man. Byron Belasco, the director of Kingdom. Suze Lanier Bramlett, she's from...
She was Hills Have Eyes. She was on Welcome Back, Connor.
Oh, Welcome Back, Connor. That's the one I was looking for. Joanna Going from Kingdom. Joe Daddy Stevenson from Kingdom. Tim Russ from Star Trek. Mac Brandt from Kingdom. George Christie from... he was the former leader of the Hell's Angels. Tony Daniels, Tony the Tiger. And Scott Schwartz from A Christmas Story. And that's just, that might be all of them. There might be a couple more that could even fit into that category, but goddamn, what a year for verbal shenanigans right there.
What a list. Yeah. What a list.
So, Mike.
So, I go first on the picks.
You do.
Yeah. I, even though you can see my the sheet I created, who I put as one, I think I might have changed my mind. My original thought was Toby Philpott, who was – it was a great interview just talking about like '60s and working with Jim Henson and all the
great,
legendary puppeteering.
And he's kind of become a friend of the show too, which is pretty cool.
Yeah. He's really good friends with my wife on Facebook, me and my wife with him. Really nice guy. But I kind of had to think it over and I'm, again, like looking through the list, I mean, there's so many I could have chose from. Mac Brandt was a honorable mention on my list. I am going with Skinny Pete, Charles Baker. The biggest reason I would say that was just like how impromptu out of blue, just like you contacting him on Twitter. And he's just started like, oh, I'm available now. And
yeah, it was like kind of like the day of. It was kind of basically the day of or the day before, maybe. I don't remember, but it was so quick. And he turned around, and I guess we caught him. I think we got him because of the pandemic, to be honest. Like, they were home.
Yeah, it could be. I mean, that's why 2020 was so great for us. Most of the people are like, well, I got nothing else better to do. But really cool just chatting with him, just like – laid back talk. I mean, there's nothing about him that makes him no ego with him. He understands the role. He loves talk about Breaking Bad and all his other work. Just really swell guy. And all. Somebody where I think if we chimed him, hey, can you come back again? He would absolutely do it. Highly recommend it. So I'm going to go with Skinny Pete, Scott, Charles Baker.
Skinny Pete was actually in my top two also. I freaking love that. I was so excited when he said yes and it came on. It was just like, just a great interview. Maybe what I'll do is release the full videos of some of these, after we, put these out. He was one of my favorite interviews that we've ever had. I went a different direction. I went with, now there was a month there where we kind of like, I was watching Kingdom. And I love the show. Mike, did you finish the show?
I still got to finish up season 3. I'm 2 episodes in.
Okay, you got to finish. So we had Joe Daddy on, Mac Brandt, Joanna going, and the director and creator of the show, Byron Belasco. And I just thought it was so cool that he came on to talk about the show. I thought he was really laid back. He was excited to do the episode. He wanted to get Kingdom kind of back out there. He's liked a lot of things on our Twitter, kind of became a friend of the show also, which is awesome because I think that guy is going to go on to do something else amazing. And again, if you've never seen the show Kingdom, there's a couple Kingdoms out there, but it's Kingdom, the MMA show on Netflix. I chose director and creator of the show Kingdom, Byron Belasco, as my pick for the TV film production category.
Yeah. The category we can't figure out a name, so we just keep on adding words to it.
Yeah. Film the stuff.
TV, commercials, home videos, YouTube sensation, TikTok dancers.
We'll call it film stuff.
Yeah.
So I went with Byron as my pick.
So I will pick the next category. Let's go with inspirational. Scott.
Holy moly. All right. Go ahead. Now, this is the list we have, but I mean, pretty much anyone could draw inspiration. So go ahead, Mike.
I mean, from the list I made up of certain names, we had Michael Bent, former world champion boxer, as we talked about before, dealing with like an abusive parent, nearly died in the ring, basically repopulating his whole career outside of boxing and all just being happy. It's a great story. Ginny Carreri, this is kind of a sad story. Her sister was murdered in Baltimore, and she's gone through a whole story where she's been basically, for lack of a better term, fighting the police to kind of look at the evidence and get some kind of justice for her sister, Jody. Justiceforjody.com, I believe, is her website if you want to see more details on that. John Bramblett, as we talked about earlier, the blind artist. Kathy Tate, the bald warrior. Coach Jim Johnson. As you may know, he was the coach that let in Jason McElwain, I want to say his name is. The child with autism who had that inspirational game where he shot like 7 3-pointers at the end and the whole school went nuts. Mike Reynolds, creators of Earthships. Tom Verney, great recurring guest on her show. He's a former cop who's also in the LGBTQ community. You might have seen him on CNN and other networks. Janet Devlin from The X Factor. She had a very sad story in all as she got her fame dealing with drug and alcohol abuse and a lot of internal demons, but she got her life together. And J.G. Burden, NFL wide receiver, now inspirational speaker for many people.
Yeah. So there's a lot there. There's a lot there you can take from. There's a lot of coming out of crap stories, I guess, if you will, like coming out of a crappy situation. So Mike, who'd you go with?
Oh, I go first.
I don't know. Let's switch it up.
Switch it up. Oh,
why not? Why not?
All right. Since I get to go first, I had like 4 highlighted as possible answers. But if I'm going to go first, I got to go with Jenny Carreri. I mean, how can you not look at that story and be inspired of the all the hardship that her family's gone through, all the stuff they had to do to kind of get attention to Jody's murder and like the lengths they've had to go. I mean, they've put up billboards, they've gone on TV, and it's just such a sad story where there, it's not even like it's a cold case. There's like actual evidence out there and it's just not being researched. Highly recommend if you go to Justice for Jody with the number 4.com to kind of look at that story, because it's a sad thing, but it's inspirational in the fact of how her and her family are kind of working together to just not give up for her sister.
Yeah. And I went with, so again, if we can help even put that story out, it was really, really interesting. Something kind of outside of our wheelhouse, I guess. We usually interview interesting people, different professions and whatnot, but this was one that, like, I was almost like, when we got the interview, I'm like, all right, we're going to do this. It's going to be interesting and different, so let's do it. And it was like it was something outside of our comfort zone, which I really actually enjoyed doing the interview. I went with, I guess he's going to get 2 Verbies this year. I went with John Bramblett. I thought just the inspiration to overcome being, you know, losing your sight and becoming an artist and powering through it. And I thought he was such a great guest, and him to be able to do visual art with no vision is pretty phenomenal. And it's just like, we sit here and we have these ideas for things and we get lazy and we don't do them. And we say, I'm going to write a book, I'm going to do this, blah, 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 blah. We never do it. And here's a guy who can't see and he's doing visual art and teaching kids. And so John Bramblett was my inspirational speaker, 2-time Verbie award winner.
That's some rare company he's in.
Yeah.
I think the Snake Milker is the only one with 2 Verbies right now.
All right, Mike, I'm going to go. You choose, right? No, I choose.
No, I choose the last one.
All right, I'm going to choose. We're going to go with the ladies of verbal shenanigans, which they're probably all would be hate to be called that.
They prefer the chicky D's, Scott. Come on.
The broads of shenanigans. The shenanigan broads. no. But Aisha Ash, get out of here. so we had a lot of phenomenal women on the show this year. So we had Heather Berman who was a Rockette, Sarah Kaufman, the cheese lady, Jenny Carreri, who Mike just picked for his inspiration. We had Eliza Cat from Eliza and the Delusionals, Kathy Tate, the Bald Warrior, Jamie Lynn Watson, the Sprintern, she's a bunch of other things. We had Sarah and Molly from the Buckleys, Ruthie Foster, who is Grammy Award winner. Nominee. She's a blues artist, really cool. Josie Cotton, like a throwback kind of musician. Janet Devlin, who was on the X Factor, an amazing singer from Ireland. Brina Cabler, who is part of the Sons of Silver with Dave Cruzan from Pearl Jam. Lenny Bramlett, the actress from Welcome Back, Cotter. Joanna Going from Kingdom and House of Cards. And Emily Rath from East of June, who is comprised with Dirk Lance from Incubus. So, Mike, would you like me to go first? Or would you like to take this one?
I will defer.
Oh! All right. So, staying with Byron Belasco, this was a no-brainer for me. I mean, I love everyone we interviewed, but when I got Joanna Going to say yes to the interview, I was excited. My wife was even excited. Like, she watched the show a little bit with me here and there, and she's like, she's a phenomenal actress. And she was one of my favorite interviews of the year. Got a lot of feedback from the Kingdom groups on Facebook and Twitter, and I just love talking to her. So Joanna Going from Kingdom, House of Cards, was by far my favorite female interview of the year.
Can't go wrong with that. That was originally my number one, but I'll go with my number two, and it's a close number two. I went with Janet Devlin.
Great.
I thought she was a great interview, very honest. It's kind of great to see the parallels of sudden fame and kind of like dealing with it. And she had like a lot of demons going into it. Yeah, it was
alcoholism, eating disorders, a bunch of stuff.
Absolutely. And it was just kind of interesting, like talking about doing with everything going through her head. And at the same time, she's on national TV singing Mbop.
Yeah.
But the great thing is she kind of got through everything. She was in the running for my inspirational, but since I wanted to make sure she got a Verbie because they all screamed for the Verbies, I'm going to go with Janet Devlin.
Yep. So tomorrow on Wikipedia, it'll be singer on X Factor, Irish singer, and then it'll be like Verbie Award winner also. So you're welcome, Janet. You're welcome, Janet. Mike, I would like to choose always a funny category. I want to go with the guest that probably won't come back ever again.
Okay.
Now, we love all our guests. We do. We are appreciative of all our guests. But from time to time, they don't hit it out of the park, you know, or we don't hit it out of the park. We're off, or the connection's bad, or there was something missing. There was that magic spice missing from the interview.
Yeah, and I would also say this category also goes to, like, not necessarily that they're bad, but maybe also we're like, all right, we're never going to get another time to get them on the show or items like that. It's your own interpretation of why you say won't come back award.
Yep, exactly. All right, Mike, would you like to choose?
I think I will start, Scott. And the award I give to today was, I would say, one of our bigger names that we ever got on the show. It was so big that we decided to make it one of our landmark numbers, number 300.
Mm-hmm.
I went with Eric Esch, a.k.a. Butterbean.
Yeah.
It's amazing what he is. The boxing career, wrestling, the K-1, everything about it. I kind of found it in other interviews after we had ours. Unless he's like really seems like close to you, he's very short answered. And I think it just didn't work out in a way where we got as entertaining of an interview as we humanly can. It was great being able to talk to him. And if we ever got like a few beers in him where he might have let down the curtain, I would love to make a return. But if I had to be honest, I think Butterbean was, it's a great name, but I'd probably tell him, Rare, you don't need to listen to that one.
Yeah. Mike, I am also going to break the rules, and I'm going with Butterbean. it was a no-brainer for me. We were laughing because it was our 300th episode. We were so excited to have him on. I think we got like a 10-minute slot or whatever it was. And unfortunately, it just didn't, you know, it didn't seem like he was super interested. There was like some connection problems too. But am I happy to say we had Butterbean on Verbal Shenanigans? Oh my God, yes. It kind of went with the Zap from American Gladiators route. Like, it was not... It wasn't great, but you know what? We would love to have... You know what? I would have Butterbean on again to try to do a redemption interview. Not for him, for us, almost. But even I was like kind of like off my game during that. Like, oh, shit. Like, I should have more questions prepared, kind of thing, for short answers. So we are both settling on Butterbean, because to me, there was no other answer to that question.
Mm. I was surprised you didn't go with Cheese Lady, not to duplicate.
Nah, Cheese Lady was cool, man.
Cool. She was. But I figured that would be like the go-to of, I guess, in not coming back as in what kind of new cheese art could we have discussed? You know what I mean?
That's a good one. Yeah. But no, I'm going Butterbean, man. Sorry.
Yep.
And Natty Bumper Car.
That kind of makes sense, but I digress.
Yes.
Scott, I guess one of our last remaining big ones with names on it.
It's a ridiculous one.
We'll have to do music.
This was the hardest one for me. You know, I'm a big music guy, so this was like by far the hardest one for me.
Yeah. Yep. It took me some time to figure out an answer on this one, but I mean, the list is just insane right now. Did we go through all of them?
Yeah, give us a crash. I mean, you don't have to go through all of them. Give us the highlights. Go ahead.
Well, I put Intel on there from Second Generation Wu. He was on the tail end after, he's in 2019, but it was after we did our Verbies that year, so I added him on here. Doug Cosmo Clifford.
Creedence Clearwater, by the way.
Not a shabby resume right there. Ruthie Foster, Dyson Knight from the Baja Men, Dryden Mitchell.
Alien Ant Farm,
the Nappy Roots, William Hung, Brian Vander Ark from the Verb Pipe. The Verb Pipe.
Yes.
Sons of Silver, Tim Russ, who was Tuvok, he was also a country singer. Tony Franklin, Stephen Perkins, probably the one that's got us the most attention, Lamal.
Big time. Yep. Got a huge response on that one.
And I think I've easily like skipped about another 12, 13 guests in there. But I think those are the biggest names to kind of mention.
I agree.
Of our list.
All right, is that? Oh, how can we forget Scott Page from Pink Floyd?
Oh, gee.
Yeah.
did they do?
Yeah, you know, they made a couple albums here and there. You know, is this my turn?
Yep, I picked a category, so after you, my friend.
All right. Well, this one was so hard for me to have the chance to talk to Doug Clifford from Creedence Clearwater was. It's mind-blowing to me because it's like you go to a family gathering and you're like your uncles and dad are into Creedence Clearwater and it's music you've been hearing your whole life. So it's just amazing to have that. To have Dryden Mitchell on from Alien Ant Farm, just a cool band. The Nappy Roots, a rap group I listened to for a while. There's amazing guys. I really love them. Sons of Silver, the drummer from Pearl Jam coming on the show. I mean, it's unbelievable some of the guests. East of June, Dirk Lance from Incubus. But to me, it stood out. It was one of my favorite interviews we've ever done on the show. And that was Stephen Perkins, the drummer from Jane's Addiction. It was, I just felt we had a connection with him. I could have talked to him for another, I don't know, 2 hours. It's just an amazing dude. One of the best drummers out there. So for me, it was a no-brainer. I would go with Stephen Perkins from Jane's Addiction.
That's not a bad pick. That was my number two on the list. When I decided to go to it, like looking over everything, I mean, some great stuff. I mean, Dyson Knight, I thought was a great interview, and it was almost like a laugh going into it. It's like, you got somebody from the Baja Men on the show, and,
yep.
But just like really laid back, cool to chat with. Like I said, Lamal, not only from the feedback we got from all his fans, but he was a very nice guy to chat with.
He was awesome.
With.
He was like great to end a year with, too. He was awesome.
Mm. Yeah, Brian Vander Ark. I love the Verb Pipe, and it was just a
and
great
you,
chat.
You said
with
that would be the song you would sing on karaoke. So without further ado, pressure. Guys, your 2021 tree. Go ahead, Mike.
Oh, I was going to do it now?
Oh, yeah, right now for everybody. Go. The whole song, too, right. not just a verse or anything. Not bad.
But I will say my pick are the Nappy Roots.
Yes. I was torn. I was torn. That was my other one. So I think we're in full.
We both had one and two on both of our lists. That's pretty. I mean, those guys are fun to chat with, talk about their career, just kind of bonding over different things. And
craft
not only
beer.
The music, the craft beer. I'm really serious when I say I can't wait to support them when their brewery opens down here. I think it's going to be opening this month, Atlanta, Tucky. I'm going to have to check that out. But, Fish Scales who's there?
The Fish Scales and
yep, they're definitely my number one. Skinny DeBell.
Skinny, yep.
Yeah, but the real fun to chat with, and Skinny, I mean, he lives in my city, so I got when this COVID's over.
Sucks for him. Sucks for him.
He's like, no, I got the COVID that doesn't get affected by that shot. Sorry, Berlu.
Yeah, yeah.
Just stay away. Buy my beer, but stay away. But really great to chat with him, so I went with the Nappy Roots.
I can't argue that whatsoever, because that was my one and two, one and 1A pick, basically. So. Berlu, I think we're down to two categories left, correct? We are down to,
yep.
We always like to do, we call it the Lucy Spraggan Award. Now, Lucy Spraggan's a really awesome, I guess you could call her a pop singer from England. She has great, like, Instagram content. I'm always like, she pops up in my stuff all the time. And we got put in touch with her. We didn't really know much about her music, honestly. And we interviewed her. She was like our favorite guest of the year. I think she might have won. I don't remember. But she might have won guest of the year. If not, she was close to our choice. And we always call it that because it was like the unexpected guest award that we just thought was, you know, phenomenal. So that's really what it comes down to. It's like a guest that we had no expectations in. Going in and who we thought was just a phenomenal guest that we would love to follow forever. You know, like Kirby Chambliss is kind of one of those, even though I was excited to talk to him. But like I talk to him now, I want to talk to him now just because I love who he is. You know what I mean? Like I love his just everything about him. Tom Verney's another guy like that. Like, you know, I knew he had credits and stuff, but just like an amazing guy I'd love to have back again. So, Mike, your Lucy Spraggan Award goes to who?
Well, I've on my considerations, I talked about Lamal and Dyson Knight. Also, Wix Patton, I thought was
great.
A great chat that we had with him. But I went with Rugby ATL, Lee Allen and Amon Matthews. It was just like on a whim, I was noticing they were advertising a new rugby team in Georgia. And I was just kind of like, yeah, that's not a thing you really hear about in the States. It's obviously huger in other countries or whatever. And what I really loved about was just like I think they understand like the sports is big, but we're still learning, and they were chatting away with us. We got to talk with some of the PR people behind the scenes. And I think the greatest moment was finding out that Lee Allen was the mountain donkey on Instagram, which was like, I was hoping we would have like games so I could just start chanting mountain donkey during the matchup.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. That was a fantastic interview. And you should go check out Rugby Atlanta, or just the rugby, the league in general. I went with, so I got put in touch with, I got to admit, I didn't know much about the guy's music beforehand. And then I had a little email come about their release and whatnot. And I was like, wow, that would be really cool to get on the podcast. And I thought our conversation was fantastic. And I guess other people also thought it was fantastic because, Mike, you had mentioned his name just a couple minutes ago. I went with Lamal. I thought the Lamal interview was really fantastic. He sang the Neverending Story. He was the lead singer of Kaja Goo Goo. I didn't really have any expectations going into it, and I felt like it was just a good interview. It was down to earth. It was, you know, he was entertaining, and he seemed into it. So my pick was Lamal for the surprising interview of the year.
So before we put out this episode, you are going to contact Lamal Stalker and let him know, listen, there's going to be a big surprise coming up. You got to watch this episode.
Yeah, Lamal Stalker has liked a bunch of our stuff, by the way. So Lamal Stalker is okay with me.
Sounds like a wrestler named Lamal Stalker.
So here it comes, Mike. The drum roll here. We are down to the final thing we do. Then I'm sorry if this bores you guys, but this is the best thing we do to kind of review what has happened over the last year. Mike, it is the best interview of the year, your favorite interview of the year. And I'm so curious if we have the same one. And if we do, I'm sticking with it anyway. Mike, who do you got? Or is it my turn?
Either or. You want to
take it? I'll go. You know what? I'll go. Okay. So this guy, I had emailed a bunch of times. Probably it was one of my longest chases, if you will, I guess. Kind of trying to get the guy on the podcast because I thought his work was really interesting. I thought it was something that we haven't done before. Like we've done a lot of music. We've done a lot of art. We've done a lot of film. We did a bunch of stuff like that before. But we haven't really gone too much behind the scenes, if that makes sense. Like, we haven't done the production side of all these amazing things we watch and love and take in. So it took me about 2 years to get this guy on, maybe a year and a half. He's become a kind of a friend of the show. He likes a bunch of our stuff. We email back and forth. In fact, we have a guest coming up next week that was recommended to me from him. I thought the connection was there. I thought his story was so interesting. I loved how he supports like young people getting into his business. I went from K&B Studios. Greg Nicotero is a right-hand man, if you will, works on the Orville, has done some of the most amazing things, Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. I went with Howard Berger.
Oh, I cannot complain with that. I mean, like you said, I mean, what's great about that interview was it was not just like a talk. It was almost like a buddy-buddy conversation, like me and the guy in the bar. It's like, oh, you do makeup and like sitting back and chatting and having a great time. And he's a friend of the show. I have no issues with your pick right there, Scott. That's a fantastic pick.
Yeah, and I would love to have Howard hopefully on again this year. So we'll see. We've talked about getting him back on, and I think it's going to happen when he has some projects coming out. So that was my pick for the year. I love that interview. It's one of my, I don't know, top 10 of all time. So, yeah, Howard Berger for me. Mike, your turn.
Well, the good news is we're giving out two awards this year, Scott. I did not pick Howard, even though absolutely great pick. And I was kind of torn on a few of them. I thought about Michael Bent a lot. I thought that was a really great interview. And I'm almost torn to just change my mind and say it's
Michael Bent. Wow. Okay.
But I think I should go with my first instinct just because I think it was one of those, this guest was one of those wow moments. I think what I loved about was just like what you and I did, like getting serious and prepping for it and getting ready for it. And though we had a limited amount of time, I felt that it wasn't a rushed interview. I felt both sides enjoyed themselves, us and our guests and the publicists. And it's just a nice, interesting thing to say that we talked to the creator of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. So my interview of the year is Kevin Eastman.
I love it because that was my, I had three, it was Howard Berger, Kevin Eastman, and Stephen Perkins for me. So those were my three I was toying with and couldn't come up with one. So I was able to kind of able to slot the other two into awards, but I 100% agree. I was so excited for that interview. It's still kind of surreal to me, like that we were able to do that and we got picked. I'm sure a lot of people and podcasts were trying to interview him, or magazines, or who knows, whatever, comic nerds and stuff like that. So I 100% agree, Mike. He was right there. He was going to be my pick. Yeah. And there are your Verbie winners of 2020. 2020 wasn't all that bad. It was kind of a great year for us. I don't know about you, Mike. It kind of reinvigorated me again. I know we always go through this kind of, you know, you kind of go in the ebbs and flows. There's nights where you're like, ugh, I got nothing to talk about. But, you know, having a kid and stuff like that, it just really put into perspective how special this time we've been able to have all these years to talk to all these people. Because, you know, like things pull you in different directions and jobs pull you in different directions and interest, you know, like you get sick of things. Like how many podcasts have you seen people put out, our friends, our comic friends, and they die on the vine after usually about a year, maybe a year and a half. There's a couple that I know that have been running. Shout out to Natty Bumpercar, still killing it. And people take breaks in months. The longest break you're getting from us is like a New Year's break, you know, a week and a half. We always try to put something out. And I hope the love comes through on these, like this episode is just, it's kind of a tribute to the love of what we're doing. I treasure this time to go interview people and kind of put together creative content. And even that, just to get some crap off the chest and tell funny stories and kind of hang out. So to me, Verbal Shenanigans is as strong as ever. We have a whole bunch of new guests coming up. Mike, I don't know if you feel the same way.
I mean, with everything that's gone on in the world, literally to the end of 2020 into 2021, I always felt this was like a great distraction. I felt we had some creative juices. We had some good kind of games and bits that just came out of the blue. I mean, it's kind of like you said, there's times I've come in, I'm like, oh yeah, we got that interview tonight. I got nothing to talk about. And just like the weirdest thing, it's like, oh, that reminds me of something. And then we're just on the weirdest flow ever. But it's really a great pleasure. I mean, it's kind of crazy. This is our seventh year.
Yep.
I want to say.
Yep.
So, I mean, the fact that it's a weekly show for 7 years for the most part, it's kind of an amazing thing. It's a great distraction. I brag about it all the time as I put up a picture on Instagram of a guy who was walking his dog during the whole storming the Capitol. Somebody, when I said, who decides to take the dog out at a time like this? Somebody answered with the Baja Men, which led to me saying, you know, I interviewed one of them. They're like, no way.
So. Yeah. Yep.
And that's the kind of way I look at it. And I will repeat what I always love about this show. We are the Potpourri Podcast. You are, it is very rarely you're going to go, oh, another whatever guest. It's going to be every week you're like, now what?
Yep.
Hold on. So,
yeah, I've had friends say we are the best at getting guests in the podcast, like a nobody game, you know, like we're a bunch of nobodies, but we work our asses off to get the guests on the show and we're happy about it. So, so if you're going to ride with us, we got another year in the book, another year coming, I should say. We got some great guests coming up. And we're going to keep the content coming. So please subscribe. Please listen to us. Please share it with your friends. Follow us on social media. Mike, anything to promote before we go?
I will reiterate what I was kind of talking about earlier. My pick for music guest, Nappy Roots. Their brewery, Atlanta Tucky Brewing, is in on Northside Drive in Atlanta, Georgia. They're going to be opening up, I believe, this month or coming soon at least. Really fun guests. I had their On the Way to GA Peach IPA, which was very delicious. That was a collaboration with Cherry Street Brewing down here. But I'm really looking forward to supporting the guys. So check them out, Atlanta Tucky Brewing.
And I will promote something coming up that I don't have all the details for, but I think it's a cool thing that Mikey would like to you might to hear. So. I got a text today from a good friend of the show, Mark Riccadonna, who's one of my favorite comedians of all time, but not even a comic, one of my favorite people of all time, one of the most down-to-earth people. Like, when your wife loves a comic that you work with, you know he's good people, because, like, everyone, like, hates, you're going out tonight, blah, 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 you know, to show down and blah. Well, Mark Riccadonna's like, oh, well, tell Mark I said hi and ask how the kids are, you know.
I'll second that motion and say I actually went out to Atlanta Comedy, like a show down here, just because I saw Mark was performing down here. And we, even though he barely knew me, I probably didn't see him for like 3 years, man. It's like we were old drinking buddies, for lack of
America. Mark's one of the most genuine dudes, one of the most creative dudes I ever met. So what is coming up in January 22nd to the 24th? We are attempting to break the Guinness Book of World Records for the longest comedy show ever done. So it's supposed to be over 3 days long, if not more, of a bunch of comedians. I don't have the comedians yet, but I do have one comedian. I am going to be doing a 15-minute set virtually, and I don't know if that means I get in the Guinness Book of World Records, but I'm very happy to be part of it because it's going to be broadcast in the UK and the Australia and the United States, obviously. But I'll be doing a set on January. Mike, is the 23rd a Saturday? My phone died. That's the only reason I'm asking.
Give me a second.
But what is really cool about it is that
Saturday,
the money's going to go to a charity that supports like kids who are they try to make like make them like rock stars who are going through chemotherapy and stuff like that, and they try to support the arts and whatnot. So I am so excited to do it. I don't care if I got to do 15 minutes in front of nobody, but if it happens and we get viewers and they're able to do it, there's a possibility of being in the Guinness Book of World Records. So go support Mark Riccadonna. I don't know if he's the one putting it together, but he has a great podcast called Drinks, Jokes, and Storytelling. So go support them. And I'll have more info on that next week because I want to put it out and I want to promote it. So you can watch my set. I am doing an 11:30 a.m. in the morning set. I don't know if everyone's, like, if you can get in for free or there's a charge. I hope there's a charge so they can raise some money. But I'm really excited about it. It's kind of cool.
So you will join Sharon Alexander in the world records, and now you'll have even more in common with her.
Well, you know what? That was my whole goal, saying yes to this show, you know? So I gotta get closer to her, be like, hey, Sharon, we have something in common.
Yeah, I feel that, you know, the wife and the kid thing, that was just a ruse to kind of like get her tempted more to you. And now with this world record, I mean,
you're not supposed to broadcast. You're not supposed to broadcast that out to the general public. Oh. But
well, you have the editing equipment of the two of us. So
well, anyway, guys, this has been fun, man. I'm excited for the new year. We got a bunch of stuff coming up. Got a calendar chock full of guests and new content. We'll be here. You know, if it's just me and Mike talking about our weird families, we'll do that too. So. Other than that, guys, life is funny and laugh at it. Keep the wind at your back.
Be in the skeleton costume later tonight.